Okay, I'm calling this meeting of the Rhinebeck Central School District Board of Education to order. It's Tuesday, December 22nd, 2015. May I have a motion to approve the minutes of the December 8th, 2015 regular meeting?
So moved.
By Lisa.
Seconded.
Seconded by Deirdre. Any amendments? All those in favor? That's unanimous. That motion passes. We now come to our first opportunity for public comment. Would any member of the public like to make a comment to the board? Okay, seeing none, we'll move on to our reports and discussion. And our first agenda item there is an update from the students who are in our Model UN program. And we're delighted to have you here. And I'll just turn it over to you.
Thank you.
Am I in your way using this?
Oh, no, not at all.
Okay.
They are going to use the screen, so.
Oh, then I will.
They need one to turn, yeah.
Definitely.
They won't be able to see. Get a visual on all of this.
Hi.
Now that, so yeah, that, it is good if you want to speak into that. It doesn't amplify for this room. You're going to have to just speak loudly for the room. What it does do is we tape this and post all the board meetings on YouTube. So that helps with the sound on YouTube. So standing there is helpful for recordings later.
Hi, everyone. I would like to thank the board for having us here today. And we're at Model United Nations Club, and we're here to talk to you about what we do. So what is Model UN? Model UN is a simulation of the United Nations, and students take step into the shoes of ambassadors from around the world from different countries, and we participate in debate, discussion of issues and crises. And how does it work? So our club is assigned a country and a topic to research, and then we strive to do the best research that really relates to the real considerations faced by the country. We then write the position papers, and we'll explain later what position papers are. After we complete the position papers, we attend a Model UN conference, like we did at in November, we attended a BARD conference, and there we used the research that we did and to really advocate for our country.
There we go.
Got it?
Okay, so the next topic that Jamie already brought up is the position paper, which we create before attending the conference. So the first step is to research the country, and then we organize papers regarding the history of the country, what's pertinent to the given topic. For example, last topic was the conference I was in was the safety of journalists in foreign countries. So you gather the history of that country, policies that that country has introduced into the United Nations, participation statements, and then the most important part of this paper is your proposals, given the history and these policies that you've researched for the United Nations. So you could say, I propose to create so such and such legislature based on this. And there are many benefits to this. First of all, it creates a great perspective for the person who's researching. So to be able to place yourself in a position that oftentimes you could disagree with. For example, if you're researching a country where they censor the media, and from our more Western perspective, we would normally protest that, you still have to rally for that in the conference and in the paper. Mm-hmm. So you gain a much more nuanced understanding of the policies and respect for the real United Nations who actually has to mediate these problems. And also, if you have an exceptional position paper, you have the opportunity to be recognized in the conference for that. Mm-hmm. So,
So a big question is why we are interested in Model UN, or why people should join Model UN. And there's 4 points outlined right there. And foremost, it puts interest into practice. A lot of us have an interest in either international relations or politics, and this club really puts that into practice on a smaller scale in order to like prepare us for the future. And it also, secondly, we also become well-versed in culture. And when we research these countries, we understand how they interact with one another, their foreign policy, how they, their ethics, their morals, and what codes they live by. And thirdly, the very nature of Model UN requires us to be up to date with current, contemporary, controversial current events. Which was, that was a little redundant, sorry. But it's a very fun way to get be informed, and it's very intellectual challenging as well.
So this November, we were able to, as I mentioned, attend the Bar and Bottle UN conference, and that was a lot of fun for all of us because it was the first time we had really been put into a real Model UN conference. And it was really exciting to be able to see like how the other delegates from the from the schools who have been to these conferences like all the time, like how they handle positions, how they bring up like subjects, how they move motion for an unmoderated caucus. And since it was a smaller conference, it was really it was like a very comfortable environment and not intimidating at all. So it was a lot of fun. And so this January, we are planning on having an International Foods Day, where every member, or hopefully every member, of the club brings a dish that embodies a certain country, whether that's just a country that the student is interested in, or a country that has like specific ancestral importance to someone. I'm really excited for that. I don't really know how to cook, so like. and then this spring, we're going to attend the Dalton Conference in New York City, which is a step up from the Bar Conference, and that is huge, and the kids are like really intimidating. So I personally am really excited to like finesse my Model UN skills to be good at this conference.
Great.
So as you heard, we went to the Bard Model United Nations Conference that was held at our very own Bard College in Rhinebeck on November 14th. So our club, because of its large size, which is really great, we had a huge variety of countries. And there were some, we had some duo delegations, which is just two delegates to one country, and some people just had one country to represent. And each delegate did extensive research and wrote really well-done position papers. And we were split into two committees of the UN. So there was the United Nations Human Rights Council, which the topic was journalism safety, and the European Union on the migration crisis, which is very current, and it was really interesting to research both of these topics. Both of them were in a general assembly format, which is, I guess, the most easily adaptable format to understand for newcomers like us. And we learned a lot. At first, we observed the other students, and then we learned how to make our own motions and engage in debates. And we worked with other students from other schools to make alliances and eventually reach resolutions. So it was a really valuable experience for our club, and because of this, we're going to be really well prepared for the Dalton Conference coming up. There's some pictures from it.
Okay, so as Anne mentioned before, we will be having an International Foods Day, and we are really excited to have this because kids from our club, like members, which we have 35 so far, will all be volunteering to make different foods from places such as Greece, India, and Korea. And we are really excited to have this because in a way we're kind of hoping that new people will come join our club because it will be open to the public, students, teachers, parents, anyone can come if they want to. And you'll have the opportunity to try foods from all around the world. And it's a really good way to represent our club. And a goal of Model UN is to educate participants about world affairs. So by understanding the culture and learning more about the country, you will have a better understanding of their political views, which will play into conferences. Because say you learn about a food from a certain country and you end up being assigned to that country, now you know something about them and you have a place to start with your research. So it's a really great way to start learning about other cultures and getting involved with world affairs.
So as previously stated, we attended the BARD Model UN Conference in November, and we're really excited to attend the Dalton Conference in April 23rd, because we'll be able to apply all our knowledge from the previous conference and apply it to this new conference. So it's held in New York City, and it's a full-day activity, so it starts in the morning at 8:30 and it runs the whole day. And so it's much more competitive than the BARD Conference, because it's held on a larger scale. And it'll be much more competitive because there'll be many more kids. So there'll be over 700 delegates to participate in 8 committees that range from General Assembly to Joint Crisis Committee. So our club has become brainstorming different countries and communities of interest, which we would like to represent. And the background guides will soon be posted in 2016. So then we'll be able to decide where we want to go. And we're really excited to attend. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yes.
Are there any
questions? Yeah, why don't we turn the lights on?
Oh, yeah.
I've got a question for you. You guys, a bunch of you referenced learning something from the BARD conference from the other students. Can you speak a little bit to what some of those things were and what you took away to be able to apply to your future debate?
And can I just ask, if you guys don't mind, if you're answering a question, just say your name, that would be great.
Oh, okay. Well, I am Jamie Walter, and I am the president of the Model United Nations Club. For the BARD conference, we actually didn't have a lot of time to prepare for it. We registered 2 weeks before the actual conference. So we get to learn a lot about how to make motions and how to make alliances. And once we got to the conference, we observed a lot at first. And then later on, we really started engaging in debate. And as you could see in the pictures, we would go up to a microphone and we would, since we already wrote our position papers on country, we would engage in debate and really advocating for our country. And in terms of, for example, if your country is not for free speech, for example, you really try to represent the country's views on that and the kind of policies like the leaders of the country took. And we really try to embody that and really promote that kind of ideas. And then later on, we move on to debate on resolutions. And first, we make alliances with other countries who have shared similar views with us. And then we later make resolutions. And at the BARD conference, we created 2 resolutions, one for the safety of journalists in terms of free speech. And the alliances were made with US, Germany, Latvia. I represent Latvia. We were all together on that. But there were also other countries, like from the Middle East and some African countries, who didn't support free speech and tried to censor that. Those are the 2 resolutions we came up with, and then we had to vote on it. So, sorry, it was a detail, but any
other questions?
I have something to add to that. So the basic format for the conference, the debate part, is you can either say, I motion for, say, a moderated caucus for a given amount of time, and then you say, speaking time, each person has 1 minute. Mm-hmm. And then a group that represents a certain country goes up to the microphone, says what they think is relevant to the question, and then as soon as that time elapses, they have to go. And then if it's an unmoderated caucus, then there isn't as much structure, and that's when you can go to different groups, make compromises depending on where your views line up.
Well, thank you first for a wonderful presentation. Mm-hmm. It's great to hear. So when you go to the conference, you get to pick the countries yourself, like they don't assign you countries, it's up to you which countries. do you represent?
Well, for the bar conference, they give you the choice to choose certain countries you would like to represent, but then at the end, since there's a lot of schools that want to represent a particular country, people tend to go for bigger countries because they have more say in particular issues. So for our school, we didn't get to choose as much, so they just assigned us countries. And I think for the Dalton conference, it's going to be similar. We did come up with 10 countries that we'd like to represent, but I think since there are going to be more than 700 delegates at the conference, they're just going to assign us countries.
And how did you choose your countries?
We just had a vote.
Democratically. I have a question. Do they sort of group schools that have clubs that have sort of at the same level in terms of like you guys? First of all, I have to say how amazing it is that you've gotten this off the ground and you're already going into competition so soon after the club was founded, and how really challenging that is and impressive it is. So a question I have is, do they try to sort of group schools together where the programs are roughly, you know, kind of equivalent, or with more experience, less experience? How does that work?
Oh, so for the BOD conference, since we were very new to this, we actually contacted the person, the director of the BOD conference, and he said the best way to do well and is the General Assembly. Mm. But the schools that are more experienced, they usually go into like joint crisis committees that are more. You really have to know more about the issues, okay. I guess. Okay. And the more experience you have, the more complex the issues you get to discuss. And I think the committees are also much smaller.
Okay.
The General Assembly is usually a lot of people. Yeah.
I thought I heard a couple of your colleagues make references to competitive aspects of this. Can you tell us more about that?
I think we were saying that because we were comparing it to the BARD conference, which is much more relaxed because it's BARD. I think it's a very small conference. I think only 6 schools were participating in this, but the one at Dalton, it's a famous conference, and it's been happening for years now, and kids from the New York City high schools usually participating in the conference. So I imagine it to be very competitive.
Are you ranked or rated, or is there some sort of a grade given? Or I'm just trying to understand how in this setting you would be competing against other schools.
Well, I think we'll be in the General Assembly because we're less experienced than other schools. But in terms of, I don't know, we're not really rewarded.
I think maybe some of your colleagues would.
You can win best delegate and stuff, like at the very end.
I see.
The people who are hosting the conference, so like the members of the BARD gathered all the other committees and joint, into one big room. And then they do award different things like best delegate, best position paper. There's some other more specific ones that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Let me just do an advertisement here. I'm probably preaching to the choir, but 4 or 5 years hence, if you still are interested, and if you can listen to the political environment out there, we need some rationality in terms of cultural diversity and things. The U.S. State Department's always looking for really well-qualified, interested people, and if you're mobile, they will transfer you every 2 years to some other country around the world and teach you the culture and teach you the language, and I'm sure you will do a wonderful job in representing the United States. So keep that in the back of your mind as a possibility, please.
I just have one last question. So you guys, this is a brand new club this year, and it's impressive the numbers of you that are in it. Did you all sort of come together last spring to talk to Dr. Davenport about forming this club? What was the impetus? Who came up with this?
Yeah, Well, I've always been interested in international relations, and while the Model UN was just something I was really hoping to establish at the school, so I went to Dr. Downward and I proposed to establish this club. And then we had an info session that a lot of people attended. And then, yeah, we got the funding from the school, and everything went great, and it started off as September. Thank you for letting us do this.
Oh, thank you.
Well, like everyone else, you guys had really, I mean, really impressive presentation. Mm-hmm. Obviously, your public speaking and analytical skills are so terrific. It's really great that there are 35 of you. It's fantastic. It's just really impressive. So we don't get to see at our board meetings, you know, we talk about it now and again, students coming and making presentations. So it really helps our work because we see the product of a lot of conversations around this table. So thank you for being here. I don't know if Mr. Moore, I want to thank you as well for being the advisor of the club. And I don't know if you have anything you want to add.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure to work with these students. I mean, they're so motivated, they're so enthusiastic. They all share this love and interest in international affairs and politics. And they've just been a joy to work with. They're self-starters. As you can see, I basically said, you have this opportunity to make this presentation, and they ran with it. So it's been a thrill.
It's fabulous.
Well, great job, and I echo what Rick said, that you know we need clear thinking, good people as leaders in our world. And Rick's son works with State Department, so thank you so much for
thank
being
you.
Here.
Thank you.
A gift. It really was a present to us, great. Wasn't it?
So we will move on now to the next item of our agenda, which is principal's report. So you guys are you don't have to stay.
You can if you want to, though.
Especially we love having you here.
To stay. Yes. Do not feel compelled to.
To the Model UN.
Good evening, everyone. A few things happening at Chancellor. I wanted to mention, in the past few principal reports, mentioned things that we're doing in the building as a staff together. So just want to let you know, we did have our second annual CLS Half Holiday Get Together at Smoky Rock this past Friday. Great success, 51 people here,
wow.
Which was really the first time we've gotten out for something like that. So we did one last year at Econorms, but it was like the middle of the week, a little bit different. So second annual, really the first time we did it, we thought, and they had a really great response. Also had our potluck, second annual potluck luncheon today. And one of the things we decided to do was start to include recipes with the dishes, sort of to plant the seed of possibly putting together a CLS staff handbook. And this kind of a question about, I talked to the PTSO about something like that, putting it together, a way of doing. There's a lot of great sites out there. We can publish things that look professional. So a lot of good cooks in the building, so it would be a great idea. So it worked out. About 3/4 of the people provided snacks of their recipe, which was great. Also wanted to, I mentioned that Sandy Kane and the CLS Grade 5 Chorus was invited to the annual Winter Songfest concert at Bard College. They did go. We had a handful of staff and parents that joined them. And the students, in addition to performing their own songs, got a chance to see a little bit of opera, some theater, cabaret, small ensembles. So it was a really good experience. Hopefully, see if we get an invite next year. Great to do it again. One update on some of the outreach. I had given you some updates last time. The one thing I wanted to mention, an initiative that we do every year, Hands Helping Hands. That's the new gloves, mittens, things like that. We have a bunch of people in the building who actually make them from scratch every year, many of them. So this year we had 147 items go to Aster Head Start, so we're really proud of that. A little shout out, a big thanks to Mrs. Fleischauer and the 5 students from her class. They performed the production of Three Little Pigs for their peers today. I had no idea they were prepping this, but I was lucky enough to find out about an hour before, so once again, I'm lucky enough to sit there and get a chance to see the production, and they did a great job reading their lines and getting into their characters. You can really tell, one of the feedback I gave to them was you can really tell their voice in these second graders, really tell these characters to heart. It's a great job. I wanted to point out after-school programs at CLS were highlighted in the December 9th through 15th issue of Northern Dutchess News. So not only did they focus on the Rhinebeck elective sponsored by the PTSO, which is always we do two sessions, one in the spring, one in the fall every year, and they fill up very quickly. They also highlighted with Flying Colors, who did their first session today. It's an art program we feature after school. So we were the school of the week section of the paper. And in addition, they also pay tribute to Val Nicolatis, who you may remember, I believe last year I mentioned, she really, this wonderful skill that she has around art, and she's been decorating these themes of the art greeter's desk. So there was a great shot of her in front of her latest creation. This right now, she's finishing up a Frozen themed picture in the front of the kid. It's amazing. This morning, I told her before she came in, there was probably 15 kids around the front of it just looking at this work that she did. Really does a beautiful job. So it was nice to see, in addition to the accolades she gets in our building, because people are just amazed by what she creates. They had a great shot of her recently. I also wanted to mention, every year we participate, I want to give props to Morgan Labrugo, our school social worker. She participates in a Book Angel project. Every year I've been there, I don't know how long it's been going on, but certainly every year I've been there, we've been participating in it, and it's an initiative called Book Angel. The merchants of Montgomery Row in the village of Rhinebeck conduct the program. And through Book Angel, pupils are chosen to receive a book based on their interests, age, gender, and we actually work with the teachers and Morgan to set this up for students. This year we have 28 students, and as we do every year, Morgan and I will take time in the morning to go around to every class and hand deliver it to each child. It comes with a letter that goes home with them to their parents explaining what it is. But it's always great. Every one of these kids light up every time they get this book. So almost 30 kids this year. Really, really great. A couple things just coming up. Our next Spirit Day is the 14th. Support your favorite team. So looking forward to that. Science Night Out was moved, sponsored by the RSF, and partnering with Bard students. It will be Wednesday, January 27th. And a few highlights. Experiments are going to include an optical illusion station, make your own lava lamp, which I think we had the first year. It was a great success. And Frankenhand, which I'm not sure what that means. The only thing I got from the RSF so far is watch it come alive. So I'm intrigued. There's just some things coming up soon.
Excellent. Great. Thank you. Thanks.
Good evening. A couple of things going on in and about BMS these days. In our 8th grade ELA classes, our students have begun a lengthy research project titled Taking a Stand, Civil Rights in America. Students determine what it means to take a stand against social injustice throughout the world through some projects earlier in the year, both in ELA and in social studies. Now we're focusing on social injustice throughout American history. They're working with local installation artist Nevia Kaminsky, as well as Pat Sexton and the folks from ENTA, and they're creating works of art. In years past, this is now the third year that we've done this. Anybody that's taking the opportunity to view the gallery that we hold at the end of the project, you'll recall that a variety of different mediums are represented. We have a number of unusual projects in the works now. I'm not going to talk too much about them because we intend to hold a gallery walk and open house in late January, early February. Follow up with an invite to that. In our 7th grade social studies classes, our students have been spending the past week investigating the precursors to the Revolutionary War. They've been doing a lot of station work in Mr. Frischkinet's classes, and the stations have been run by our high school students. As I know, I've reported out on a number of occasions over the past couple of years, the middle school and the high school are looking for ways to really kind of pool our resources and use the expertise in our building, in our high school students, to work with our middle schoolers. And we thank Mr. Berg and Mr. Krishnanath for soliciting. We had more than 30 high school students that participated in this, you know, many giving up multiple free periods, lunch periods throughout the course of the week, but more than 30 total students participated in this project throughout the week. I'd like to take a moment to recognize one of my faculty members, Tom Glass. I recently discovered, and I'm embarrassed to say recently, but I recently discovered that when we switched last year over to the Common Core algebra program, the modules, and we've upgraded the math curriculum in the eighth grade, Mr. Glass, who recently came over and began working in my building, took it upon himself to create his own YouTube channel, which is titled 8th Grade Math Homework Helper Series and contains 116 videos. They're about 5-6 minutes long each, and they coincide with every homework assignment that is assigned by Mary Fuchs in her math classes. You may know he's one of our special ed education consultant teachers. Not only did he do this and is it being utilized by his CSE students, but Ms. Fuchs has put this out to everyone in the eighth grade. And as I scrolled through the list of videos today, I saw that some of them had 5, 6, 8 views, and others had 60, 70, all the way up to 111
views. Oh my God, wow.
So it's a fantastic web-based resource. It's audio and video, and it's really being utilized by our eighth grade students, so I was very pleased to talk with him a little bit further about that. Sponsored by our art club, our 6th annual Knit for the Needy campaign is just ending. We have more than 50 students, faculty members, parents, grandparents participate. I think I talked a little bit about this in my last board report right after this had just begun. Pleased to report that at current count, just this afternoon, we've got 52 blankets and 6 hats that have been made by our students and friends. We have quite a number more that we expect to come in tomorrow, but all of these items will be donated with handwritten tags and notes from our students to the Vassar Hospital NICU on Christmas Eve. Brett mentioned the Book Angel Project again this year, and Morgan's been working with Megan Rodier, our school's social worker, and I believe this is the third year now that Book Angel Project has come on up into the middle school too. And I'm pleased to report that I believe we have 18 students that are going to be receiving books through the Book Angel Project tomorrow prior to the last evening, Buckley Middle School was recognized as a celebrity fundraiser down in New York City for our participation in Zara Amos Tech Drive. Henry Frischkinet was in attendance on our behalf to represent us. He was pleased to report to me today that all of the items that we collected and donated are currently with 2 of Zara Amos members in flight and on their way to Madison Square today. A couple of upcoming events. On January 14th, members of the Peer Leadership Club will spend the day presenting to each of the first grade classes regarding Malagasy traditions and culture. They've developed multimedia presentations, arts and crafts projects, and games that they're going to be doing with the students over at CLS. On January 26th, our 8th grade students will be traveling to Bard to participate in the Day of Science, as they've done for the last several years. And finally, our BMS choral concert will be held on Thursday, January 28th at 7:30 p.m.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone.
Hi.
I'd like to begin. I'm very pleased to begin by announcing that in the first time in Mr. Kemitzer's and my tenure at the school district, all of our varsity sports teams in the fall season have been named scholar athlete teams by the New York State Public High School Athletic Association.
Great.
Which means that each of those teams has each of those teams has a composite grade point average of a 90 or above. And as you know, we have eight sports teams, two cross-country girls and boys, two soccer girls and boys, volleyball, field hockey, swimming, golf. So that's quite an accomplishment. Congrats to the student athletes, coaches, teachers, parent support. In addition, 54 of our varsity athletes were named as individual scholar athletes by the Mid-Hudson Athletic League, and they have a grade point average of 90 or above. So again, it's quite a great accomplishment. And when Mr. Boucher shared that with me, and I shared it with Mr. Kemmerer, it was very, very exciting. And BLPT news and a couple of updates. Our revised parent-teacher conference format was well received, and we plan on continuing that in future with a few refinements here and there. The BLPT is continuing to review senior exit surveys, and we're also looking at recommending bringing in several speakers for our students. In the spring, already with the help from our school resource officers, we'll have an impact speaker named J.C. Good spoke with our kids about 4 years ago regarding the dangers of texting while driving. We'd also like to bring in a speaker on diversity, Dr. Michael Fallon, who's very well received. He's spoken to other area schools, so a very important message. And finally, we're looking for some opportunities to help prepare our graduating seniors for life after high school and how to best navigate those challenges and those decisions. So we got some speakers to come in to give students, our graduating seniors, some of that important information. And some operational updates. We have a draft of our program of studies, currently reviewing several proposed additions to the program of studies. And once that's, we've discussed that with the superintendent, with the subcommittee on curriculum, obviously the board will be apprised of some of those courses. As has been suggested in the most recent high school newsletter, I think that went out today, there's a description, hopefully not too long-winded, on the master scheduling process or writing process that I worked with the guidance counselors to share with the community so they can get an idea of the steps that we take in writing the schedule for each year. In academics, in environmental science, our science students completed a lab in which they measured the amounts of protein in different foods in order to determine which sources of protein are most sustainable and would be most useful in some developing countries. In our physics classes, students are testing their engineering skills by designing packaging for eggs, which packages they then propel at a wall at increasing levels of velocity. It's a very interesting construction. Recently, Deputy Sheriff O'Brien spoke to our forensics classes regarding the use of dogs in the forensics work. He was accompanied with a very popular guest named Libby, who is half lab and half hound dog. Very friendly guest. Now, thanks to the Rhinebeck High School Concert Band, Jazz Band, Stiller Band, and Percussion Ensemble for their winter concert. It featured the percussion ensemble performing a composition written for kitchen utensils, which sounded very good.
Yeah.
And as I walked backstage, there was actually music written for kitchen utensils, which was amazing. The men's and women's courses performed for the Chamber of Commerce last week, and then went on to give five performances for the residents of the Thompson House, mm-hmm. not all of them were ambulatory, so they went to different parts of the facility, so all the residents could enjoy them. Again, I have many co-curricular updates. Our Creative Writing Club sponsored the first annual Poetry Out Loud competition, and thanks to our guest judges, Deirdre Delbert, Michael Ives, and Jeff Katz for their participation and for their very valuable feedback. We inducted 19 students into the National Honor Society. All of our classes, grades 9 through 12, with sponsorship from the Student Council, participated in the Claudio Cares Food Drive. The freshman class won the competition locally, collecting 300 food items to donate. Across the county, my understanding is that 130,000 separate food items were donated for this food drive. The band is conducting an iPod drive. They're collecting iPods, MP3 players, other music devices to refurbish and share with residents of the Thompson House to enjoy music. In other tech news, the newly formed High School Technology Club will also be sponsoring a tech drive in which they'll be soliciting donations of any digital technology, computers, desktops, phones, tablets, to donate to a worthy cause. Our newly formed French Club sponsored a day of peace. Students and faculty wore t-shirts on which they drew a design of the Eiffel Tower peace symbol to support the victims of terrorism in France and across the world, and to show support for and advocate for peace. Our diversity club wrote some holiday letters to the children at the Astor Home. Our Spanish club has commenced their tutoring Tuesdays. That's with upper class. Spanish students are available to help students in Spanish 1 and 2 master the complexities of the subjunctive in Spanish. Auditions have taken place for the school musical, and rehearsals will begin soon after winter break. We have a unique opportunity this year. The band is planning and proposing a field trip to Manhattan to see Fiddler on the Roof, which is being performed on Broadway. Many of those students will be in the pit band, so it's a nice and again, a unique opportunity to see two versions of, yes, of that great show. Looking ahead, we have financial aid night for juniors and seniors, January 5th. There's a time change that's going to commence at 6:30, not 7, in order to accommodate our expert, our guest speaker. And our winter choral concert will take place on January 20th.
A lot going on. Any questions?
Thank you.
Well, I just want to also just like thematically, all three of you say, just to like highlight really that at every school, all our students are involved in, you know, giving to the community and the spirit of giving in the multiple ways, whether it's the hands helping hands or the knitting or the Claudio Cares food drive, performing at the Thompson House. I mean, it's really wonderful how much our kids participate in giving to people who need in our community and people like outside of our community who they don't even know. So I appreciate that. And I also want to thank you guys who called out particular staff who were involved in some activities, because really it's been one of our goals over the past couple of years to try and do more recognition of our staff. So it's great to hear the kinds of work that our staff do often, as you mentioned, above and beyond what they're doing day in and day out in the school building. So thanks so much. Enjoy your winter break.
Yes.
Yeah.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays. It means to us.
All right, well, that's always uplifting, which is good. The next topic is the 2016-17 budget development update.
Which is depressing.
Exactly, so I will turn it over.
So you want me to preach? Make it joyful. This is a rollover budget. Really, what I'm doing here is just taking everything as is and putting some increases the number and some decreases things that we do know about. So let's not go to the first page. We'll come back to the tax cap, and then the next two pages after that are the revenues, and we start with the rollover expenditure budget. Now, I'm not going to go line by line or anything like that because really, this is a rollover. It's really the first draft that you need to have some more specifics. So, just give you an idea, in this document, with the salaries, everybody's in there that was in there today. I've increased it by contractual amounts that are with the RTA and the ANI contracts, which are settled for the administrators and other personnel. Increases are in the benefit section, just to let you know, until those become, you know, finalized. Once they're finalized, then they will be put into the regular budget. Equipment, material supplies, textbooks, contractual expenses, they all remain the same. BOCES, I increased where I knew that we were under budget, such as like occupational education, which is increasing in cost. Benefits, ERS and TRS, their rates dropped. That's reflected in here. But likewise, health insurance, I have going up at a rate of 8%. That's usually what I've started out with. And hopefully we see that back off as we go along. One of the things that you'll see also in here is debt service decreased by over $100,000. So we put some debt service to bed. So it decreased our budget by about $100,000. But it does have an effect on the tax cap, which I'll tell you about. It has actually, it decreases your taxes, but I'll go through it. And we'll talk about that because this is the first year in the tax cap we actually have those figures are moving. And you've never had to deal with this before. So, you know, nothing too exciting at all as we went through this with the as this was, I know, sent out last night, and didn't have a whole lot of time to look through it and that. So, but what I try to do is to, you'll see some increases through here. In some cases, you know, in most cases, the just increases to salaries as you go through here, and most of that, pretty much everything else is remaining the same. Like I said, the only places I really went at were the BOCES services, and even in the first draft, when that comes out in 3 weeks, the BOCES services are still going to be an estimate because I won't have their information yet. I'll just have to be taking my best guesstimate for some of these things. In special education, also what I did in a couple areas, under special education, the 2250.
What page are you on?
This is page 11 of 18. You'll see that there's an increase in tuition of about $100,000, and then you see a decrease of $15,000. And basically what I did with that was all the current people who are in programs, but I added two unanticipated placements, you know, because you always want to have a little bit of a buffer there. Mm-hmm. We have not looked to see if anybody is graduating out of a program, coming back to the district. Who are my four-year-olds coming up into kindergarten, whether or not that is, but that will be ready for the first draft. But I wanted to put that in there because you definitely would want that in a budget, give yourself some cushion. The other area that I want to explain a little bit is in page 16. This is in transportation. What I did was also kind of basically the same thing. I went with not the current rates. I went with the rates from our oldest, our old company, Durham. I thought that was a more reflective of what I'm hoping would be the worst case scenario. But also in this case too, I've added in two additional bus runs because we totally maxed out all that I had budgeted for. Just in case, I had an extra one for special education, in case somebody moves into a school we don't go to, and one for private and parochial schools, because you move in, you go to a school that's in 15 miles, we don't have a bus going there, I gotta provide one. So those are kind of the big differences. When we get to the whole bottom line on page 18, we're looking at an increase of approximately $750,000 on a rollover, or 2.36%. I started receiving the budgets from a couple of the administrators so far, and should, you know, receive the rest of them in the next day or so. Well, tomorrow, actually. So we will then be able to get our first draft, which will be presented on January 12th. So let's go back to the front page. And that's what the tax levy limit. So let's go through this. But some good news and some bad news as we go along here. So we start with last year's tax levy, $26.5 million. And you'll see a tax base growth factor, 1.13%. It's by far the biggest number that we've ever experienced here. Huh. That means the entire wealth of new construction in this school district increased by 1.13%, which will help offset any tax increases. Remember, now we got 1.13% more people helping out. Mm-hmm. So in reality too, is if you really looked at it last year, if you really looked at your tax bill, even though, and I don't know the specific numbers, I think it went up 1.62%, but in most cases, because we had a growth factor of like a 0.6, people's tax bill only went up 1% because that additional 0.62 picked up the rest of the tax bill. Mm-hmm. So usually people's tax increase is the allowable levy growth, which we'll get to in a second. So the 1.13 was very good. Payments in lieu of taxes, levies exempted from the prior year. We'll talk about that in a second because there is a change on that in the next page. Right now, the last time we had talked, the allowable levy growth factor was 0.31. Mm-hmm. The other day, for those, I think it's the villages who start on June 1st, their levy rate came out at 0.12. Mm-hmm. So it's continuing to drop. So we have one more month before our rate comes out. So just using that one, 1.13, 0.12, about 1.25%, we're looking for as a growth as a, for a tax levy, but there's some modifications to that. So we subtract out the payments in lieu of taxes. That number is incorrect. It's slightly bigger than that, but I couldn't find the piece of paper I was looking for. We'll adjust that for the first draft.
Over which number?
The 17,887. So it's going to be in the 18,500 range. It has a slight decrease, but not tremendous. If we go on to the second page, and on the left-hand side, the capital local expenditures, $1.1 million. On the previous page, it's $1.148 million. All right, there's a difference there. We having $100,000 in our debt being coming off our budget because it's been satisfied. So we're not paying that extra $100,000. Well, a part of the tax levy limit and the legislation is, well, it just doesn't, you just don't get, oh, that's more money for me. They have a formula in which what happens is, okay, so we're spending $100,000 less in debt. Well, $40,000 came from the state in building aid. $60,000 came from the tax, from taxes levied on our community. So I have to decrease my state aid by $40,000, and I got to decrease my tax levy by $60,000 because I don't need that money for that purpose any longer. So you can't use it to say, and that's what I had hoped in the beginning when we started this whole thing. Oh boy, I can't wait till this year, we'll have it extra money. No, they have it in their formula, it takes that money out of there. So even though our levy's down by 100,000, between state aid and taxes, I gotta decrease that by 100,000 too. So it's not like it's found money, I can use it and put it someplace else. I can't do it. In the old days you could, now you can't. As we look over to this side, we get a bottom figure of a 1.09% tax levy. Now that this is on a rollover. We still got a little bit more ways. We got state aid runs to go through. Mm-hmm. We still have the levy growth factor, but it's gonna be somewhere in that area. Maybe it goes a little higher, maybe a little lower. It all depends on our state aid figures. And hopefully they turn out to be very good. If we go to the next page, which is the revenue budget, all I did was increase taxes. There is no increase to anything else. So as we take it, well, actually I did decrease by non-resident tuition because we currently don't have anybody. So I wanted to decrease that. This isn't making sense. This isn't right. This isn't. Sorry, guys. Take that completely out of there.
What?
That isn't.
That, page?
That is not it. That's the 15-16 rollover. I don't know. So take those two pages out of there. Okay. Just take them out. I will go down and I will
destroy
copy
those.
Them off and destroy them. That's last year's rollover budget. But suffice it to say, that number was about $640,000 in the tax levy. It was like 2.78%, if I remember correctly off the top of my head. But that, hold on. I think I got it right here. Sorry. My pronouns. Yes, here it is. what nothing changes on this, so I'll give this to you. The only thing that increases is the real property taxes, and to level it all out, it was $747,000, or 2.88%. So we got 747, and we have a currently a tax levy of $289,000, so that difference is, I don't remember off the top, about $460,000 is the gap right now. But I wouldn't worry too much until we get that first draft out. I mean, this is just a rollover, everything in place. So right now we have a gap of about $450,000. That's no increases to state aid, no changes, you know, along that line. Mm-hmm. So so I'll get a copy of this before you leave tonight so I can put that in for you, because that's
so Tom, that's just to sort of summarize the data, that your rollover budget, you know, as of today, in the format that you described, making the allowances you described, the tax levy increase would be 2.36%. Your estimated allowable tax levy increase is 1.09%. And that, in real dollars, comes out to a gap of about $450,000.
Yeah, yeah. It's 2.88% is the rollover tax increase with a 1.09% tax levy. Difference is approximately $460,000. So yeah, between 450 and 460 is the is that dollar amount. Mm-hmm.
Okay. People have some questions for Tom.
So this is looks like the tax levy limit's less than last year, but better than we were looking at earlier.
Right. Yes, and that, and for our school district, the 1.13% of the with the tax-based growth factor, that's the biggest in the county. And in the county, Poughkeepsie's at zero, no increase at all. So the ones that need the most help, but I mean, they have no growth there at all.
That's why they need the help.
That's, yeah, that's, their tax base is what it is, and it's not growing. With our district, I mean, you look around, you see stuff going on. You have the hospital, you see houses, you know, here and there. I mean, there's no large developments going on, but you see construction going on, and, and that is helping us to, in the community. What's that?
Paper. They did get some money from the shark.
TV. That's right.
Oh, that's right. Yes.
That's right. A little bit.
That's nice.
So, are there questions for Tom?
Yes. So, stay tuned. Very preliminary, very early, as always.
And so, our schedule is that the first draft budget will be on January
12th. Okay. Great.
All right, thank you, Tom. So we move now to our board committee reports, and we have quite a few. We can start with communication.
Okay, that's me. So we started out talking with Steve Jensen about the district website. He shared some new images for the opening slider. We talked a little bit more about sourcing photographers' work and what, if any, conflicts there were for us in terms of having for-profit photographers donate their images to the website. We've since gotten an update from legal counsel that we are welcome to credit any photographer. We just can't use a for-profit logo on the site anywhere. The food service section is still in development. It will ultimately have general nutrition information, My School Bucks links, menus for each of the schools, and policies and forms for parents to access. This part of the site, and I'm a little unclear whether it'll be holistically around the site, but this part of the site in specific will have a translation function to Spanish for families who would prefer that. He was pleased to share that they're really in the cleanup phase on the site. It seems that they're getting many fewer queries about problems and issues that teachers are finding arise, and so that's heartening. And for January, he's going to bring the metadata to us so that we have an idea of how many people are accessing the site, how many teacher pages are being used, who's using the teacher pages pages for homework and things like that. He's also working on putting more professional development videos together for teachers so that they have refresher courses on how to set up pages and format things as they like. We then spent the balance of our meeting talking about our advocacy issues. We are recommending, as you will see in the letter that Joe's handed out, that our communications focus on full restoration of the GEA, increased foundation aid, and equitable funding for all schools in New York State. So as we start finalizing these letters, we're going to share them not only with each other and get approval from all of you, but we'll send them to the governor, our legislators, and then we're going to send them out to our community at large, because part of what we are hoping to do with the blessing of the board is to try to engage our community in lending their voices to the conversation around advocating for appropriate funding for public education. We talked about the potential for an online petition versus, what was the other one? I didn't underline it. A petition or a letter, just a draft letter that people could customize for themselves. So we'd like some feedback from you guys about how you feel about using either or both or none of those options. We have a letter from Joe in first draft form, and once we get approval, we'll be able to send that out. And then once we hear the state of the state from our governor on the 13th, we'll be able to better hone our ideas of how best to advocate moving forward. So, and then we're hoping in February to set up meetings with PTSO, Rhinebeck Science Foundation, Young Rhinebeck, to talk about some advocacy efforts and ways we can work together. Okay. Right. Yeah.
Great. Any questions for communications?
So much a question, just as far as you're looking for feedback for the advocacy from the parents. I mean, we're certainly not forcing anyone to do anything, we're just providing information. So I think either of these, I mean, I'm comfortable with either of these, by providing information for them. And they should be advocating as well.
Mm-hmm. I think a question was, like, if we developed a petition, would people be comfortable with that, posting that on our website? Maybe as part, petition set.
As part of our advocacy
would
goal.
It would goal depend on the petition.
Right, I mean, it always depends what it says, but I mean, if you're comfortable with that, I mean, it's, again, it's not forced on anyone. They don't have to sign it or be part of it. It's totally up to them, but it's just a way to help them help the schools.
Well, Joe, did you want to
I mean, I can address it now. I was going to mention it under other. I apologize for not having that interview before tonight's meeting, but I drafted a letter that addressed actually four different cornerstones of the state's existing plan to fund public schools, specifically the tax levy cap, gap elimination adjustment, inadequate foundation aid, and inequitable funding, followed by four bullet points advocating for what we would like to see reflected. This is just a draft. Feel free, and I will send you this digitally in case you're inclined, and I would encourage you to be inclined to, you know, mark it up or make suggestions and get it back to me. So you'll get the digital copy first thing tomorrow morning from me, and please provide me with your feedback.
Okay.
I don't you should sit here and read this.
No.
CDS,
right.
Not good use of time.
Okay. Thank you, Joe, for doing that.
Sure.
Yes. So if there are no other questions for communications, then we'll move on to the audit committee report.
guilty.
It's also you.
Guilty again. So we met for the first time this year and started our meeting off talking about the internal audit that we have had in the works with the payroll audit, which has been conducted by our auditor. They're compiling the information. We're hoping to have some update from them in the new year. Tom also briefed us about sort of some of the activities of the State Comptroller's Office. They're conducting their audits as they do every year. This year they seem to be focusing on information technology. He was given a copy of the Onteora School District's audit to share with us so we could get a sense of what kinds of things the Comptroller is looking at. This is an area that had been called out in our risk assessment in 2013, so it has been on the laundry list of things to do. It's now just a little bit more important, it seems. We're suggesting that that be the focus of our internal audit for this year, which has been budgeted for. In specific, they're looking at things along the lines of disaster recovery, disposal of equipment, and security awareness for all employees. Vanacore is not particularly geared to this type of audit, so we're looking around for recommendations on IT-specific auditors who can help us out in the coming year. Then we were joined by Tim Thomas from Toski, our external auditor. Overall, as in the past number of years, it's a very clean audit, and Tom and his staff have been complimented for providing excellent information for the audit. Of particular note, New York State schools statewide have been grossly overbilled by the teacher retirement system. So we've been overbilled to date by about $8.7 million, which is just a huge number for a tiny little district like ours, and I'm sure it's just astronomical for the bigger guys. It's no fault of New York State schools. That money is swept right into the TRS system. We never see it here in our bank accounts. So Tim was suggesting that we try to reach out to NISBA and talk together with other school districts about advocating for reduction or more appropriate funding levels of that fund. As we all know, due to the unforeseen addition of $500,000 in special education costs for school year 2014-15, our unrestricted fund balance is very low for this year. So Tim suggested, and Tom and I had spoken about developing a five-year spending plan so that we can try to massage the numbers a little bit more long-term so that we can maybe mitigate some of those mm-hmm. ups and downs. Mm-hmm. So Tim's going to be finishing up his final letter to the board and will present us all sometime in January or February. Next time we're going to keep talking about the IT audit, and we'll review the corrective action letter that Tom pro forma has to put together for our audit. That's it.
Okay. Thank you.
Laura, the item about the overbilling by TRS, is that money that would come out of our state aid allotment that is sort of deducted at the top?
No. They do take it out of our state aid. That's how they fund themselves. It comes out of state aid, okay. It doesn't affect the amount of state aid we get. It's just that they take it and instead of giving it to the school district, they bypass us and give it right to the retirement system.
So it does affect the amount of state aid we get
in
the school.
Right, correct. They would just be giving it us for us to turn around and give it to them. So they kind of cut out the middleman.
It was us.
Fair. Yeah, they actually is a little bit in a way. What it basically has happened is, as you know, for the longest time it was very low. And when we hit the Great Recession 7-8 years ago, TRS, they're unlike a school district, they are allowed to put money into Wall Street, a certain percentage of it. So when Wall Street takes a hit, the retirement systems take a hit. Well, how do they make up that money? They come to us, the school district, and ask for a bigger contribution. And we saw that. We at one point, we're almost at zero, and then we almost got up to near 20% over the years. And, you know, right now it's, I don't remember the number off the top of my head, it's like 14%, going down to around 12 next year. But what has occurred over the past couple of years, just like the stock market, it's rebounded. So they've recovered their assets from the downfall 7-8 years ago. They've recovered those assets. But now the school district's kicked in more money, and they put that into the stock market, and that's earned more money. So it's up and, you know, beyond the level. And if I remember Tim's number, he said that the pension system is funded at 110%. So it's 10% overfunded. Mm-hmm. So what this money is set aside for is they want a certain pot of money so that future retirees are living off the interest that's earned that year, and you're not affecting the principal. And that's what happened, you know, 7-8 years ago. They were eating into the principal. So it does seem as though now that they're flush with cash, and I think they can help out by lowering the contribution rate to us.
Well, what I'm trying to understand is if advocacy efforts were successful to cause TRS to be required to return money, would that money come back to the school districts, or would it come back to the state? Would we benefit from it or not?
No, the best way, if it was to be handled, is to reduce the contribution rate. So instead of next year, the contribution rate being 12%, it'd be great if they can come out and say, hey, we can go down to 10.5.
Right.
Okay.
So we save it in the budget.
They just take
stuff. Exactly. That's okay. Exactly. They reduce the contribution rate.
Okay.
Would be the way I would advocate to give us money, to get money back to the school districts.
Okay. I see. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
And there was a document that you received, I'm not sure from what state office or from TRS itself, right?
Yeah.
That you saw in the audit committee that gives that number. So.
Yeah, there's a new report. I think it's called GASB 68. And we get a report now from the New York State Employees Retirement System and the New York State Teacher Retirement System. And they use an actuary to look to see how well they are funded. Mm-hmm. By the actuary. And that's why Tim was saying, you know, they're overfunded, whereas ERS is underfunded. But it's a lot less to us. It's not as much. As Tim was saying, ERS is a big to-do with the New York State itself.
Yes.
New York State contributes to ERS. Mm-hmm. They don't contribute to TRS. I guess they can through the SUNY school. I mean, the SUNY colleges and that. But as Tim said, they don't use TRS. They use TIAA CREF, which is a whole different mechanism altogether.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for audit? Okay, thank you, Laura. Next in our packet is the school start time payments.
That's me. So the committee met for the purpose of reviewing the December 8th presentation and going over that. This meeting was on December 15th, and the information was just put on the website a day or two prior to that meeting, and at that time there were 52 views on YouTube, 120 views of the presentation on the website, and the presentation material was downloaded 80 times, which was really great considering it was like a day or two just out.
Posted the night before.
Yeah, so it was not out very long, so I think that and the public attendance was really good for that meeting. We talked about the five scenarios, the five options we have, and the group really feels that the options that will cost the district additional money, you know, just still are not going to be something that we're going to be able to do unless the rest of the board would like us to keep looking at them. So if we put those aside, that leaves us with doing nothing or the shift option. And the committee really wants to try to see if we can make that option work without any change to the chancellor schedule. That would be what we would like to do. So we're looking at the bus schedules, and we're going to meet with Mr. King to see if we can look at the chancellor schedule and really look at it very detailed, actually like make a schedule at the time, class by class, and go through the bus schedules. Tom gave us a preliminary look at the bus schedules, like when they come in and out, which really boggles your mind, but we're like, look at that. You know, really go through kind of with a fine-tooth comb to see every minute of the day exactly what that option could look like and try to problem solve that. What else? So that's what we're going to do in our next step, is try to go through that option. We had a few questions, just two questions that came after the meeting that were on index cards from parents. One of those was asking how we will assess the failure of a one-year pilot and what factors we would consider. And that's just something we touched on just generally. It's a great question and something that we definitely have to look at. If we go through with a pilot program for next year, we want to, you know, mm-hmm. what's that going to look like? The other question that came from the parent was did we look at before and after school care. So Joe's reaching out to the provider of the before and after school care, and we're going to look at numbers of how many kids participate in that. So we're looking for the board to give us your thoughts in any direction. We're coming up, the athletic department would need to know by February if they're going to be making any schedule changes for next year. So we're keeping that in mind as we, you know, progress in the next month and a half here. So opening it up for you guys to give us any feedback you've had now that you've had time to think about the presentation and the information that's been given out. So.
Can I just add that we did take very seriously the concerns that were raised not only by teachers but by families around the end of the school day and Chancellor. And just to reiterate that we would very much like to find a way to, if the board believes it's the right thing to do in terms of moving forward, a way to not change the end of that day. Right? Am I correct in stating that as strongly as possible, that we had been looking at like different scenarios where it was, you know, 7 minutes, different minutes, numbers of minutes had been entertained, but that really it seems like we would like to find a solution that would not push that day any later for the Chancellor kids.
I think in all fairness, though, we should say as we sit here today that we don't know for sure that that's possible.
Right, right.
But it's going to take a lot of work and looking at various scenarios to see if it is possible. But I think we're feeling that on the basis of the presentation on December 8th, the feedback we got both that evening as well as all the surveying we've done of parents and students and teachers, that we need to start narrowing the options. We can't develop detailed scenarios for four or five different options. I mean, it's just too overwhelming. The board's original charge to the subcommittee was to come up with a scenario that was cost neutral. We felt that we had to look at all the possible scenarios, and as you know from the meeting on December 8th, three of the five scenarios were not cost neutral. They were costs anywhere between the mid to the upper $20,000 additional to $600,000 to $1,010,000 for the one trip option, I think. So I guess we're throwing out that the one that seems most feasible and cost neutral with some possible tweaks would be the shift option, and we want some guidance from the full board as to whether we should continue to explore that or not.
Yes.
We're looking for marching orders from the full board at this point.
I think Rick had his hand up, unless you wanted to elaborate on
there was just
the
one other thing I want to say. I mean, the committee's, anytime we've gotten information that has been a concern, for instance, the later time for Chancellor, you know, when the committee's really like look to, you know, problem solve mm-hmm. that. Mm-hmm. And we did spend some time talking about the effect for working parents.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we talked about mm-hmm. that we kind of came up with, it's very difficult because the school day is not the same as a typical work day. It's shorter in length. So any change you make, it's just impossible to kind of account for every scenario with a working parent. You know, for some it's gonna be better, a shift, for some it will be worse. We didn't really see anything that we mm-hmm. could come up with to
I mean, the current school day is not.
Right. It just isn't in accordance with the 9-to-5 and hours. It doesn't match up. So there's always going to be, you know, an issue for working parents in the school day.
But I'm sorry. Can I just amplify that point a little bit? The other thing that we are very mindful of is that we don't want to adversely affect the chancellor kids. Right. We're talking about health and wellness of kids, and we heard very loudly from the teachers at Chancellor that they're concerned about little kids. They're ready to go super early in the morning, and they really are fried by the end of the day. So we are going to invite Brett to come and talk to us a little bit about problem solving, how to structure the chancellor day overall, and maybe there are better ways to engage those kids, you know, in better time frames and, you know, at different times for different kinds of activities, because, you know, they all have very full schedules after school too, so we don't want to kill them.
Lisa?
Did you want to go first, Rick?
I don't have a
question. Okay. All right, so.
It's the issue.
So I guess we're closing in on the point where the committee is going to be very soon making some sort of recommendation to us. And although, you know, the pieces are kind of falling into place so you can forecast what that recommendation may be, I recognize that you've not yet made a final determination and that you're still processing what you've learned and trying to gather more information. I take that seriously and I really appreciate it a lot. My question, and it may not be a question you can answer tonight, but I would at least like to throw it into the hopper of things that you're thinking about, is not just can we accomplish this and are there ways to problem solve issues that people have raised, but overall will the change that we may be capable of making be a good change for the district. You know, there are a lot of people in the community who have positive things to say about making the start time later for the middle school and high school students. That, you know, that's based on evidence, and it's the evidence that we've as a board taken seriously. But because of the various issues that you've all identified and you've all looked at, I just want to get a sense when we get to the point where you're making whatever recommendation you ultimately make, whether you've assessed the sort of the overarching issue of whether it's good to make a change, it's not good to make a change, or making a change is kind of an unknown quantity. And if that's the outcome, that's okay, in my view. But I'd like to at least get that sense. So that's why I'm throwing this out there.
That's a good question.
Deirdre? Yeah, I don't know if we as a group have like formulated a coordinated statement, but I'm just, so tell me if I'm wrong, colleagues, but I think that it seems to me from the kinds of feedback and conversations we're having that we do believe it's worth exploring to the point to make a proposal of some kind. I mean, am I wrong or?
Okay.
It seems to me that a recommendation that is able to address some of the concerns that we've heard is likely something that we would be making a recommendation. If we get to the point of saying, you know what, we're unable to address these concerns, that may lead us to another conclusion. And we can't say until we go through this kind of this second phase of really fine-tuning what we're suggesting appears to be the most doable scenario that doesn't create harm educationally or socially or otherwise, but that remains to be seen. We could get to the end of that kind of sub part of the study and say, you know what, we just can't do it, or we can't do it without spending more money or whatever, and that may cause us to rethink whether any of those options are workable. That appears to us to be, on the face of it, the most likely to be able to work, but it's going to take more time on our part to really shave minutes and run schedules and see if there are other things that we can do. You know, can we, without creating any other issues, you know, we don't want to solve problems and create other problems.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, we'll look and we'll talk with the building principal at Chancellor, and, you know, maybe there's a way we can reduce the amount of time necessary for dismissal, which may save some time on that. I'm not saying we can or we can't, but I think we're kind of down to the nitty-gritty of how that plan would work in the real world, and we want your go-ahead to say, yeah, go check that, or tell us, you know what, doesn't matter, we're up for, as a board, we're up for spending $1 million more to do a I'm being facetious, of course.
From whence would that come?
Don't say that.
But my point is, give us direction and we'll work out the fine details, and then we'll know whether we can make a recommendation or say, you know what, we still couldn't do it.
At least I think, you know, if the committee makes a recommendation to make do this for a pilot, you know, each board member is still going to have to decide.
Right.
You know, this is going to be a change. If the committee recommended to make a change, it will be a change to the lives of the members of our community.
Yes.
And each board member will have to weigh if you think that this change is worth it. You know,
of
no
course.
Matter what we recommend, you each will have to make that decision, you know, based on the information that we have. And, you know, it's not necessarily going to be an easy decision for anyone because, you know, it's a little bit of the unknown.
I understand that. I appreciate that. But, I mean, just personally, you've done such a wonderful job bringing the project to this point. I'm really overwhelmed by the amount of work and the thought that you brought to this process. It's hard for me, as I sit here now, to say, well, the committee's made X recommendation, but I'm going to reject it because of other considerations. It's just hard for me to imagine being in that position.
Deirdre.
I really want to say how impressed I was by something you said, Joe, in one of our most recent meeting where you talked about, you know, working with different groups of people who have a vested interest and concern, very strong concerns, whether that's parents or students or teachers, right? And you use that wonderful phrase, we're problem solvers. Let's be problem solvers. So on the one hand, there's this kind of logistical challenge that we haven't yet gotten to the end of figuring out, right? But the other hand is our conviction that the health and wellness benefits are, you know, of such value that it's worth trying to be problem solvers. So I think what we need to know from all of you is if we have your blessing to try to get to that kind of granular level of logistics and present a final proposal.
How I do. I raised the hand at the
Rick?
Yes, please continue and clarify things so that I can get closer to being able to decide how to vote here. Please do that.
Yes. Okay. I agree.
Okay. Yeah, and I'll say that that I agree. I think, you know, I agree with Lisa that you guys have really done a great job. You really have looked at all the issues. You've done tons of communication with the community, which is fantastic. And so you've covered all the bases, as was noted by a previous board member at that meeting. You know, this is a conversation we've had in this district years ago. You guys have really come the closest to trying to come up with a scenario where we can try something that's going to be a change and you know, a little nervous making for everybody. But if you can, you know, you're asking all the right questions. You honed in on, I think, the, you know, the most particular concern, which is the impact on Chancellor. So yeah, coming up with, I think, a kind of deep, sharing those details with us, that would be when you ask, like, what would be the next steps for us, is like the proposal having that granularity and all the impact. I know there were some thoughts about, well, do you change the bell schedule a little bit? So when we all have that information, but you've come this far, if we want to address this issue, and try it at all, you're still our best shot at it. So I do want to ask, though, is there going to be, I thought there was mention that, that perhaps there would be another survey done after all this information.
Yeah,
so is
survey.
That what's, is that in the works?
And we didn't talk about it at this debrief meeting, but
kind of tight
it's pretty tight.
Does Steve Boucher need to know by like early February?
There's some flexibility there, but earlier rather than later in terms of February. And I think, well, one thing we found is that we've been able to turn the surveys around pretty quickly.
Yeah.
You know, we use SurveyMonkey to do that. It's pretty easy to put it together. It does all the data analysis for you. I mean, we've had data days after we've closed the survey, so it's not a weeks-long process. It's really a days-long process. And I think perhaps, although we haven't really come to any decision, but perhaps if and when we get to the point of being able to work out some of the logistical glitches right now, maybe that's the point at which we're surveying again specific to this plan, and this way we'd be able to say if we were able to do X and X and X and X and not have to do Y and Y and Y and Y, would you be supportive of this? What are we missing? You know, what other issues are there that we haven't addressed? And I think at that point, we could come back to the full board with some confidence, hopefully, in the survey data to say, yeah, we're recommending this to you. Right. Or, you know what, there's still so many more issues that have now arisen from the second results of surveying that we have to go a different route. Right.
So that would, just to follow up with that, that would be, I would think that would be a good idea, however you frame the questions, because that would be, if you're looking for minutes, another shift, and our students have been well trained with how many minutes between classes. I'm sure it's just like a natural understanding to them physically how much time they have between classes, and you know, kind of alerting people to that potential should that be one of the changes you recommend.
Right.
Lisa.
The other thing that I just wanted to make sure to say, and I think Diane, you alluded to it when you were talking the minutes through, was that I think that now that we're coming down to the end game of the study process, that we also need to start, and meaning you guys need to start, thinking about what the parameters are going to be for testing whether the pilot's successful.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
I mean, we didn't focus on that because we don't know where we're going, so we'll...
Right, right. But, I mean, as part of a recommendation, I think we've also got to have at least an outline of that.
Assessment, an assessment plan.
I think if there, you know, there's only a few board meetings, two or three before February, so if there's any information that the rest of you would want before you would make a decision that you don't already have or isn't out there, you know, you probably should let the committee know, you know, if there's something you want. I mean, I think it's all out there, but in case there was something else you wanted to know.
All right. Any other questions or comments on this? All right. Thanks for your continued support. And Diane, you're on the next minutes as well. Facilities.
Okay. We were joined by.
They had you do the minutes even though you were via phone?
No, I wasn't via phone.
Sorry. Oh, okay. I guess I was.
She listened Marcus. Very carefully.
Marcus.
Via phone. It was minutes by default. We were joined by Mr. Hamlin and Ms. Spoufard from Tektra Tech, the architect. He's an architect, she's an engineer, who did the building condition survey. So they were joined by us, and they had put together a priority list similar to what Sheldon had done for us the meeting before. What was nice is that the lists were almost identical. They matched up. And they went through this list with us. There are 60 items on the list. We went through each item so that everybody on the committee could understand exactly what each item was, why it was on the list, talked about cost in some of them, how they came up with the cost, and why, you know, everything was on the list. And it was very helpful for us to have a really good understanding of why everything was there. He did give us, there were several items on the list that are listed as code violations, but we weren't sure exactly what that meant, because some of them were grandfathered in because they weren't a code violation when the building was built. But they explained that it's important to consider doing them because, for instance, if you have a door and the violation is with the handle, if you do anything with the door, you're now not grandfathered in. So, you know, unless you're sure that you're not going to do any work in the area where that violation is, you probably should just fix it because you could lose that status. So there's several items on the list that fall into that category. They'll help us look into the possibility of doing an energy efficiency project with any lighting that we have to fix. So that's a possibility to go down the road and look at that. Next thing, Tom's going to be working with the fiscal advisors to look at the numbers and see what currently the project is listed. The estimate's about $10 million. Tom's going to look at the numbers. We're going to see what that looks like. So when we come back together, we can say if we need to cut that back or, you know, where we're at, what that will actually mean to the taxpayers. They just wanted to also point out that they wanted to thank Sheldon for all his help in putting this together, that in a lot of districts, you know, they're out of access, but nobody really helps them. He was very helpful in putting this process together, making it run very smooth, so great ops to him.
All right, any questions for facilities?